was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I had failed, but you were my redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed from a ruined treasure. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, letting go and trusting where I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, surely every season you are good to me.
Good morning. Welcome to Village Bible Church. It's great to see you this morning. Great to have you here. Before we start our worship time this morning, I thought I would read from Isaiah chapter 12. This is a great chapter about preparing our hearts for worship and why we worship. Verse 1, "You will say in that day, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, for though you were angry with me, your anger turned away that you might comfort me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust. I will not be afraid, for the Lord God is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously." Amen. "Let this be made known in all the earth. Shout and sing for joy, O inhabitant of Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel." Isn't he good? Isn't he worth singing to this morning? Giving him praise, lifting him up. It's not about us, it's about him. Amen. We're gonna kick off our worship this morning by singing "God is for us." But that's even though he is so good, and we don't deserve anything from him, he is for us. He supports us. He loves us. Amen. Will you stand with us as we sing out this song to him this morning? God is for us.
The battle, we won't fear the night. We will walk the valley with you by our side. You will go before us, you will lead the way. We have found a refuge, only you can save. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Even when I stumble, even when I fall, even when I turn back, still your love is sure. You will not abandon, you will not forsake. You will cheer me on with never-ending grace. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Neither height nor depth can separate us. Hell and death will not defeat us. He who gave his Son to free us holds me in his love. Neither height nor depth can separate us. Hell and death will not defeat us. He who gave his Son to free us holds me in his love. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us?
I love that last line, who can stand against us if our God is for us? And just to update you, I'm getting credit for my elliptical workout at the moment. It's always good. Amazing grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Alleluia. 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 Grace that brought my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Alleluia. Many times
danger, storms, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that's brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. Alleluia. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Alleluia. Saved a wretch like me. Alleluia.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, Village. It's nice to be with you this morning. I had three people ask me why I had a tucked-in shirt. I don't know whether to be offended or complimented or... I thought... You know, I'm an authority figure. I don't know, but whatever. Just a few announcements today. Number one, we have a new way for you to get announcements. We put out our first video last week of VBC TV, and yeah, it's a clever name. I know. I'm gonna go ahead and take credit for that. So it's a time where I'm gonna have a guest on, and we just talk about all that's going on in the church. Last week it was Riley Jefferson, and she's our new social marketing person. So make sure you check those out. They're going to be real short, so you can watch them on a lunch break or just in your free time. Second, all student ministries are happening this week. Normal things. We have youth group from 6 to 8, and we have young adult group on Thursday night, and that'll be at 7. That's at the 620 house. And the last thing I have for you is small groups. Again, one of our biggest missions right now is to get everyone involved in a small group. We want to see people plugging in. We want to see people having community and making friends in the church. And there's no better way than coming together and reading the word together. So I'm going to invite Tom Haydock just to hear a little bit about his small group. And I've gotten to attend this small group. Actually, I got to be there like at the genesis of it, you know, at the start. And I'm blessed by that because I've gotten to know these people and it is so much fun.
Thank you. You saw the slides, all the different small groups, and I think small groups is so important to the overall church experience. It's another great way to praise our Lord, and it's a great way to just get to know each other. I'm blessed to be in a great small group. We've got it running like clockwork. Jeff and Brenda... Jeff and Brenda Sheppel, they handle all the hosting part of it. Pre-COVID, we were at their house, but now we're meeting in the coffee bar, and they do a great job of just handling all the emails and everything like that, which frees me up to just focus on the lesson each week, which I love doing. We've been studying the book of Acts, and we have learned so much about the early church. And we just have a great time. We meet every Wednesday night in the coffee bar right now, starting at 7 o'clock. We usually end up around sometime between 8 and 8:30. And again, we're studying the book of Acts. We like to have a good time. We do some serious praying for each other. And we're just a very close group. But you know what? There's always room for more. There's always room for more. And so we encourage you to either join our small group or another small group and take advantage of that because it's really, really great. We even had like a board game night separate, and we had a great time. Vic even taught us how to cheat at play dominoes. But anyway, we'd love to see you come out and one way or another join a small group.
Thank you so much, Tom. That should be a slogan we adopt, right? There's always room for more. Never be afraid to join a small group, but we haven't hit capacity in any of them, I promise. We'd love to have you. So, Ken, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you. All right, let me walk over here, because they tell me that I can roam a little bit. Is that right? I guess so. All right. Did you have a birthday this last week?
Yes, sir.
You did have a birthday. Will you tell me what? Can I ask you your age?
Of course you may. 86.
86.
Isn't that marvelous?
Wow, that is marvelous. Yeah. They sit up here with all the young people. Okay, that's good. Did you have a birthday this week?
Yes, I did.
Let me tell you.
Yes.
No, 21, you are not telling the truth. No.
25.
Happy birthday, Craig. All right, let's see here. All right, let me see. The people that are looking at their feet right now had birthdays. Did you have a birthday this week? No. Wouldn't it have been fun if you had? Who had a birthday this week? Anybody else? All right, well, Craig and Barb, we're going to sing happy birthday to you right now, okay? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Barb and Craig. Happy birthday to you. Heather, you're sure you didn't have a birthday? All right. Take your Bibles, and would you join me for a minute in the book of Isaiah? Isaiah, almost in the very middle of the Bible. Isaiah, and I think the text will also be up on the screen behind me. This passage is, my goal here is that we would read from God's Word some words of encouragement. These are great, great words of encouragement. Isaiah chapter 40, and I'm going to begin reading here at verse number 21. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is He who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them out like a tent to dwell in. He brings the princes to nothing. He makes the judges of the earth useless. Scarcely shall they be planted. Scarcely shall they be sown. Scarcely shall their stock take root in the earth, when He will also blow on them and they will wither, and the whirlwind will take them away like stubble. To whom then will you liken me? Or to whom shall I be equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things, who brings out their hosts by number. He calls them all by name, by the greatness of His might and the strength of His power. Not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my just claim is passed over by my God, you say? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the Creator of the ends of the earth, He never faints nor is weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, He increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall utterly fall. But those who wait on the Lord, they'll renew their strength. They'll mount up with wings like eagles. They'll run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. A word from our God. Let's pray. Father, You are totally in charge. Every week, we come together and we rejoice in Your sovereignty. And this morning, Lord, we've read from Your word that You remind us that why do we ask all these questions and forget that you are the one who just knows it all, and you love us. You're in charge. Lord, sometimes we look around us, and it does look like just a bunch of grasshoppers fluttering here and there and jumping here and there. And yet, Lord, in the midst of all that commotion, we know, Lord, that you are on the throne. You are in charge. You are still. You are powerful, and you love us. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's stand.
Salvation. Thank you for unending grace. Thank you for your hope. Thank you for this life you give. There is no one like you.
For your kindness.
the cross. Thank you for the price you paid. When peace like a
you deserve. Lord, what an opportunity we have to do that, the freedom that we have to do that. Lord, now as we look to study your word, we just pray that we'd have open minds, open hearts to what you want to teach us this morning. Amen.
Last Sunday, we mentioned the fact that Mary Crothers, who was helping us with praise and worship last week, that her son-in-law had been in a serious automobile accident, you know, Mary and Kevin. And he's at Methodist. He was put on a ventilator, and his wife, Kelly, is also with us this morning. So, Kelly, we want to take a moment here and pray for Rodney. Can we do that? Let's just all pray. Father, we know that you're the great physician. And Lord, we pray not because it just is kind of the religious thing to do, but we pray because we need you. We need help. We right now, Lord, would pray that you would just direct the doctors and the nurses at Methodist and that they would make the right decisions for Rodney. God, I pray for Kelly and for the family. And God, we just pray that that which we quote so often would become a reality in their life, and that is that they would have the peace of God that would pass all human understanding. Lord, we love you, and again, we know that you are a miracle-working God. Nothing's too big for you. We trust you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you take your Bible, and we're going to be in the book of Matthew, and we're going to continue our study that we started last week, but we're going to start out in Mark. So if you take your Bibles, turn to Mark, chapter number 9, and here's what we're going to do. A little bit different. I'm going to read the passage of the story that we're going to be unpacking in the book of Matthew, but I'm going to read it first from the book of Mark. You know, often this happens. We have different Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and they are telling the same story. And so we call that the harmony of the Gospels. And in this particular case, I think that Mark gives us some information, some facts that help us as we go back to the book of Matthew and we unpack the book of Matthew. So all I'm going to do is read this story from Mark, and you follow along. It'll be Mark chapter number 9, beginning at verse number 14. And I'll read it, and then we'll have a word of prayer, and then we're going to go back to Matthew, and we're actually going to unpack the passage that is our passage for today. All right, Mark chapter 9, verse number 14. And when he came to the disciples, he saw a great multitude around them and scribes disputing with them. Immediately when they saw him, all the people were greatly amazed and running to him, greeted him. And he asked the scribes, "What are you discussing with them?" Then one of the crowd answered and said, "Teacher, I brought you my son who has a mute spirit. And wherever it seizes him, where it throws him down, he foams at the mouth, he gnashes his teeth, and he becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples that they should cast it out, but they could not." He answered him and said, "O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me." Then they brought him to him. And when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him, and he fell on the ground, and he wallowed, foaming at the mouth. And so he asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "Well, from childhood. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." And Jesus said to him, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "Deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more." Then the spirit cried out, convulsed him greatly, and came out of him. And he became as one dead, so that many said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he had come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" And he said to them, "This kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting." Just a side word here real quick. The word fasting, the last word in that 29th verse, is not found in the original manuscripts. So he said unto them, "This kind can come out by nothing but prayer." Would you bow with me? Father, as we heard the reading of this story, we remind ourselves that this is your word. It's true. It's an historical account. And now, Lord, in a moment, we're going to look not only at Mark's rendition of this, but what Matthew has to say. And we pray, God, that you would do what only you can do. We pray that you would give us eyes to see the truth. We pray, Lord, that you would give hearts to us that could be molded and shaped. We pray, Lord, that you would give us ears to hear. And we pray, Lord, that we would leave today different than when we came in. Lord, we pray that you would do again what only you can do. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, now join me in the book of Matthew, and we'll pick it up there. Matthew chapter number 17. Give you a moment to find that. Matthew 17, and we'll begin here in verse number 14 and in just a minute. I would like to begin this morning by making this strong statement. I can't do this. I can't do it. I can't change anybody's heart. I can't give you ears to hear. I can't do that. I can't somehow get your attention in a way that you will want in the worst way to follow the Lord and to obey him. I can't do it. I am deplete. I really can't do that. But he can. But he can. And that is the whole message of this passage of Scripture. But he can. But he can. If you were here last week, you'll remember that the Lord very graciously, because by now the apostles are a little bit discouraged. And they are discouraged because the Lord has said to them that unless you take up your cross and follow me, or if you need to die to self, and that's discouraging messages. And so as a result of that, the Lord knows that they're discouraged. And so what the Lord does is he takes three, remember last week? Takes three of the 12, Peter, James, and John, and he takes them up on a mountain. And that's the Mount of Transfiguration. And there what he does is he shows them something that's unbelievable. He shows them the glory of God as it's demonstrated for just a nanosecond in the face of the Lord Jesus Christ up there on the Mount of Transfiguration. It is a wonderful, spectacular moment. It's a moment that will forever and did forever change the life of Peter, James, and John. Wonderful. They also met there. They saw that when Jesus was there and in that moment of that his transfiguration, the glory of God being demonstrated, Moses was there and Elijah was there. And we unpacked that a little bit last week and talked about the significance of that, how great that is, that Moses, the great lawgiver, Jesus Christ did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. And so anyway, last week we saw this mountaintop experience. It was exciting. Here's a time in history that is unmatched. It's absolutely spectacular where Peter, James, and John would have this marvelous experience there on the Mount of Transfiguration. And then you remember afterwards the Lord says to them, now don't go tell anybody now. And it was the timing issue. Don't tell them now because, again, people would want to take Christ now, 6 months too early, and take him now to be king. And he has yet to die. He has yet to go to the cross. He has yet to be buried and to be resurrected from the grave. But we go from, and we talked last week about the fact that the apostles often, during this seminary training that they're going through with the Lord, and they've been with the Lord now for about 3 years, and it's about 6 months before he's going to go to the cross. And during this three-year period, the apostles have been on a roller coaster. One moment they're up, then they're down. Then they're up, then they're down. And here, last week, what we saw is that three of them were way up, Peter, James, and John. Nine of them were left behind. And We don't know exactly why. Maybe we get a little hint of why as we look at the passage that we're going to look at today. Because when we first look at this story that I just read in Mark and that we'll look closer at in the book of Matthew, it looks like what the Lord's doing is he's taking the remaining nine apostles and he's not giving them a mountaintop experience, but he's throwing them right to the ground. And he's saying, you're failures. He's saying, you can't do this. And he's putting them as low. I mean, they have got to be discouraged. You see, what's happening here is that as Jesus and the three come down from the mountain and they come back down into the valley, here's a multitude of people. And some of them are just the regular multitude that keep following because they love the miracles and they love the teaching. But we also have scribes. We have that religious group. The religious group that keep wanting to hurt Christ and somehow to get in the way of his ministry. And to say, he's blaspheming because he's making clear that he's God. So they come down and here's the multitude and here's the scribes. And here are the nine. And as they come down, they learn that while they've been up on the mountain seeing the glory of God, down here there's been a dad who has a boy who from birth has been demon-possessed. Mark makes that clear. It says here that he has something like epilepsy. And again, we don't want to make that a strong connection, but he has been troubled by a demon, possessed by a demon since the time of birth. And there are times that he convulses and he throws his body around and sometimes he'll throw his body into water and sometimes he'll convulse and throw his body into a fire. I mean, this is a terrible situation. And the dad comes with his son and he comes to the nine apostles. The nine apostles who just not very long ago, back in chapter number 10, we see the Lord sent them out. And he said, you go out and heal, and you go out and share the gospel. And now these nine who had come back very successful, now here they are, and this man's coming and saying, hey, can you do this? Here's my son, and he's demon-possessed, and can you cast the demon out of him? I think probably what happened was one of the nine said, well, we did that before, and we know how that's done. We remember the steps we went through. We remember the methodology. We remembered how it worked. And I'll go first. Sure, I'll do this. And so he goes to the boy and tries to cast the demon out, and it's a failure. Probably another one steps up and says, hey, you did that wrong. Let me have at it. And so he steps in and he tries to cast the demon out and it doesn't work. And then another one comes up. And the passage of scripture, guys, makes it very clear that every one of the nine think they can do this. And none of them can. Not a one of them. They cannot do it. And as I mentioned earlier, boy, that appears to be, is the Lord being mean to him? Is the Lord saying, I gave Peter, James, and John this wonderful experience on the mountaintop, and now I'm going to come back and I'm going to make fun of you guys? And that isn't at all what's happening. The Lord's doing the same thing down in the valley that he did on the mountain. What he's saying is that, hey, guys, this is not about you. You can't do this. You can't even do a little bit of it. You can't even begin to touch this. But I can. I can. You come to me. What you can't do, I can do. Now, I don't know where you guys are today in your individual lives. Some of you, maybe this morning, are wrestling with a marriage. And can I just say this? You can't do it. You cannot do it. Now you say, well, Ken, I disagree with you. I know lots of people that aren't Christians and they have great marriages. They don't have a marriage that is what all that God wants that marriage to be. You cannot do it. Some of you are here today and you think, you know, I'm really dealing with depression. And what I'm doing is I'm studying all the things that I can do. You cannot do it. You cannot do it. You can go to the best counselors in the world. You can go to the best and read the best books in the world. You can go to the best workshops in the world. You can go to the best places in the world. You can get all the pieces and you can memorize them. You can learn them and you can walk through all of those steps. And guys, you and I cannot do it. There is a spiritual dimension out there. There is the kingdom of God out there that the Lord's been talking about. There is all that Jesus Christ is about because he happens to be the king of that kingdom. And there are things that are in our lives that you can't do. In Tom Haydock's teaching on Wednesdays, he gives a pop quiz every once in a while. And then they hand out a prize to the person that's done the best job in their quiz. And then he gives them a trophy. And the trophy is for the smarty pants of the small groups. It's the small group smarty pants trophy. How do you like that? Well, let me just say this. I don't think I'm being too rude. I'm just making a strong point. And the strong point is this. If you think... that through education, if you think through reading a book, if you think through sitting down with a counselor, if you think that somehow filling in all the blanks, if you think that you can get this all figured out and that you can make it work, smarty pants, you can't do it. You cannot do it. The Lord handed 9 men a beautiful gift. And that gift was to say, hey guys, I'm going to give you a vivid opportunity to totally fail because it's in failure that you begin to learn you can't do it, but I can. And God's people said, I can. I can. And I want to. And I will. Now you say, well, what about these 9 though? Well, we can't get inside of each one of them and understand exactly what they were thinking, but, you know, maybe they were thinking that, listen, we've done this before, and so what we're going to do is we're going to lean on past experience. That won't fly. It'll fly when it comes to the health of the world. And what we can do is with all of our education and our intellect and our methodology, we can go out and we can help one another as far as the world goes, but we can't as far as the kingdom of God goes. There are certain things that we can't do. We cannot give a person a new heart. Christ can. We cannot create regeneration. Christ can. We cannot create a great marriage. We cannot. Don't be smarty pants and say you can. You cannot. But Christ can. You cannot get this thing of your depression all figured out. You cannot do it on your own. But Christ can. And one of the greatest blessings in your life and my life is when we get, in fact, I was being a little bit silly at the beginning of my message, but not too silly. Every single Sunday, and I've done this for over 50 years, I sit there in the front, I'm ready to get up here, and I think to myself, Ken Dalton, in a moment you're going to try to do something you cannot do. I have not been commissioned in order to give out information. I've been commissioned to be God's man, to take God's word and to present it with God's Holy Spirit, opening ears and opening hearts and changing minds so that people's lives are changed. That's what it takes. And what a beautiful gift the Lord is giving to these nine men. He comes down and he says, didn't work, did it? Says, each one of you tried, and you thought because of experience, and you thought because you had paid attention in seminary school, and you thought because of this, and you thought because of that, that you really, man, you did it. One of the greatest challenges that the evangelical church in America, more so than in other countries, but one of the greatest problems that the church in America faces is that the American church can say, well, you know what? We know we've been called to do church. And so what we're going to do is we're going to make sure if, you know, we did it. We had enough money. We had a wonderful building. We had a wonderful location. We had a wonderful band. We had a wonderful entertaining church service. We had a wonderful program. We had wonderful lighting. We had a wonderful sound system. We had a wonderful this, that. We had wonderful personalities. We had all of that. And lo and behold, we did it. Only what was done wasn't necessarily what the Lord did. When he says, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Well, let's look at it. We're in verse number 14. Francis Chan. How many of you know the name Francis Chan? Francis Chan is a young pastor, has a real heart for the Lord, heart for the Word of God. And his own testimony is this. He says, I can tell you right now that if you have, see, he in California for a while, he pastored a mega church. I mean, it was huge and blowing the socks off of growth. And he makes this statement. He said, I can tell you from firsthand experience. He says, if you have enough money, if you have a good building, if you have a good location, if you have a terrific band, and if you have a teacher that has somewhat of a okay personality and is able to communicate, and I forget all the other things that he mentioned, but he said, I learned through experience that you can do all of that and you can grow a huge church and you don't need God's help at all. You wouldn't even need the Holy Spirit. That's the lesson that these nine guys are learning. Hey guys, I'm going to send you out. And I want you to remember this, that you can't do it. Everything that I'm asking you to do, you can't do it. But you can come to me. And you can believe and know of a surety that I can. And what I can do is as you die to self and realize you can't and invite me, I can through you. I can do what you cannot do. I mentioned marriage as an example, health, job issues. People have issues with jobs. I want to be smart about this. You're not smart enough. You can't do it. Relationships. You got a problem with a relationship with somebody? You got a problem with relationships in the community? Guess what? You can't do it. You can't do it. Don't be smarty pants about this. You can't do it. But the Lord can. And what a wonderful blessing it is when at times in our life we're brought to the point that on our knees, maybe on our faces, we finally come to the Lord and say, I cannot do this, but you can. And the big smile on the Lord at that point, that's how this works. I work through you. Now, let's look at it. It says here in verse number 14, and when they had come to the multitude, a man came to him, kneeling down to him and saying, verse 15, again, we're in chapter 17, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he's an epileptic, and he suffers severely, for he often falls into the fire and often into the water. So I brought him to your disciples, but they could not do it. They couldn't cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him here to me, me. And Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him. And the child was cured from that very hour. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately, and they said, why couldn't we do it? Why could we not cast it out? And Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief. Actually, the idea here is for your incorrect belief. Your incorrect belief of believing in yourselves and your knowledge and your understanding and your ability and your lack of belief in the fact that this can only be done by me. By me. Because of your unbelief, for assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. However, this kind does not go out except by prayer. And again, the word fasting is not in the original manuscripts. I think that, it is so tempting for all of us to want to get into the flesh. And even here, the ones that took from the original manuscripts and put them into the Bible that we have today, we're tempted to add one little word here that just said, it led us off to think that, well, this is going to come about if we really, really work hard and we fast hard and we labor hard and we get, and that somehow we will get more faith, that we'll get bigger faith, that our faith will get stronger, and before long what happens is we're in love with fasting and we're in love with faith and we're in love with all, again, it's us. The Lord is not saying that I want you to somehow pull faith up from your toes and up to your ankles and through your legs and into, and that you're going to be full of faith. Well, what he's saying is that the object of your faith is what you're missing. I, Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, I'm the object of your faith. Right now, all you need is me. The object of your faith is not your faith. The object of your faith is not your persistence. The object of your faith is, boy, I'm at a point where this is not going to work without the intervention of God Himself, Jesus Christ. What a wonderful truth. With whatever you're dealing with, financial pressure, you can't do it. Give up and come to the Lord and learn the beauty of laying on your face before the Lord and just saying, Lord, you can do this. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to trust you. I think today that the word faith maybe is a difficult word for all of us, and that maybe we understand the word trust better. Because that's really what the Lord's saying. He's not saying, get the power of positive thinking. He's not saying you can do anything if you believe it enough. He's not saying that at all. He's saying, where is your trust? Trust me. You can't do this. Let me real quick run through some takeaways here. Number one, I jotted down in my notes, the blessing of recognizing personal failure. If you have not in your life as a Christian oftentimes reached the point of personal failure, you've missed out on a blessing. The greatest time of growth in your life and mine is when we recognize our deficiency and our personal failure. Number two, the temptation to be self-confident. Same idea. The temptation to be self-confident. I've done this so many times, we say. We were out there traveling and we healed people. The apostles probably said, we did this, we did that. And so here we go again. We know how to do this. Three, the temptation to stop praying after a while. You know, we come to the Lord and we pray about something, and then we pray about it, and then we pray about it. Then we say, well, I'm going to quit now. I've prayed an awful long time about this. Isn't it wonderful what the Lord does for us? He says, no, it doesn't work that way. When you know that what you're praying is my will, you never quit praying it. You pray it, and you pray it, and you pray it, and you keep on praying it, and you pray it all the way up through your entire life. There's somebody that you've been praying for that they would come to know Christ. And you say, oh man, I have prayed for their salvation for so long. I'm just going to quit. No. What wonderful growth happens in our life when the longer it goes, the more opportunity you and I have to stop and say, now, do I know what God's will is here? Am I still trusting the Lord? Do you keep on praying? And you die, and they still haven't come to know the Lord. And as you take that last breath, you think to yourself, but they're still going to get saved. I don't even have to be here. I just don't ever stop praying. Don't ever quit trusting in the one who can do it. Well, we pray. Don't quit too early. The temptation to rely on our past experiences or abilities. Number five, we can learn here the object of our faith is always the key. Always, 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 always. The object of our faith. What is our faith in Christ? The temptation to lean on the power of our faith. I've kind of alluded to that before, that somehow we're going to get this great faith. We pray correctly when we have no other choice. Isn't that great? I jotted that down. That's worth writing down. You and I know how to pray when we know we have no other choice. No other choice. I was thinking this week about the talent shows, you know, and probably all of us have seen at least one or two of the talent shows where they're going to sing and try to win, or they're going to do a magic act and they're going to try to win or something, all these talent shows. And you see always that they kind of have the same format where you got these people backstage and there's some guy there that is encouraging them and so forth, and you got the family there, and then they're going to go out there and they're going to do their thing. And before they go out there, somebody always says, or even before they get that far along, somebody comes to them and says, hey, you can do it. You can do this. That's the way we live today. Thinking that we're really helping people by saying, hey, you can do this. And how offensive is it when over and over within the Word of God, the Lord says, you can't do this. And the Apostle Paul, in his writings over and over again, keeps saying to us, when I am weak, then I am strong. I will glory in mine infirmities. Wow. You see, the kingdom of God is upside down or right side up, or it's different than the way the rest of the world operates. football team. They're getting ready to go out there at the beginning of the game, and the coach is going to have one last word with them. It could be any team, not only football. It could be volleyball. It could be soccer. It could be cross country. It could be any number of sporting events. And the coach brings everybody together, and he says to everybody, okay, now, guys, we've worked at this. We've trained for this. Now, listen, you can do it. You can do it. The TV evangelists get on the TV and they say, listen, guys, you can do it. And then you come to Village Bible Church on Sunday morning, and a short, little, fat, bald-headed man says, I'm sorry, you can't do it. You can't. But he can. He can. We're not in the business of the power of positive thinking. We're not even in the business of behavioral change. We're in the business of saying to people, you can be a whole new creation in Christ. Everything else passes away. Everything becomes new. You die to self. You take up your cross. You follow the Lord. And you understand that when you are weak, you are strong. And you and I will be given the privilege by the one who loves us so much, over and over again, he's going to give us the privilege to come to different times in our life where we say, man, I can't do this. I can't deal with this addiction. No, you can't. I can't deal with depression. No, you can't. I can't really work out this marriage problem. No, you can't. You can't. But praise the Lord for the fact that he can. Is that a good word? Thank the Lord for the fact that he can. Look to him. This morning, I know that what I've attempted to do, I could not do. Maybe I have not. But I do believe this. I know the one who can. And I believe that the one who can, if you'll let him, will speak to your own heart right now. And what I couldn't do, he can do right now in you. Change your thinking. Change your heart. Make you a new person. You can't do it. You cannot do it. But he can. Thank you, Lord, because you can. Amen. Let's pray. Father, you're so, so loving and kind. Lord, if we get hasty, we could read these verses and scratch our heads and say, why be so mean? Why be so mean to these nine men? And then, Lord, as we take time to reflect, we come away saying, oh, how sweet, how loving. You're getting ready to leave. And they need this to burn in their hearts. They can't do this that they've been called to do. But you can. And every step along the way, they need to fall before you and say, I trust you, not me. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's stand.
Being here, I find my rest. And
grace is found is where you are, and where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me, and where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. I want defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. So teach my soul to rise. Temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you.
Pretty fitting way to end the service this morning, amen. Lord bless you. Have a great week.